Thank you so much for watching. My name's Scooter, you're watching Regular Veteran, and this week is different because usually the news is just so spot on, you know? And this week,
the news didn't cover the news that is important this week, per the usual, and we gotta talk about it.
They're pulling 450 people off the couch.
They didn't actually give us any sort of breakdown of what those personnel looked like.
We do begin tonight with the catastrophic flooding in the Northeast. Vermont under a state of emergency tonight. Some of the worst flooding in nearly 100 years.
The capital of Vermont is entirely cut off from the state. Water is not receding, and there are concerns that a nearby dam could overflow for the very first time.
And to the south in Ludlow, Vermont, these train tracks on an active freight line, look at this, now suspended 100 feet in the air after the earth beneath them was washed away.
Now, despite all that damage, no one, thankfully, was killed in this flooding. Thanks for joining us.
2 months worth of rain fell in just 24 hours.
Researchers collected water samples directly from taps at 716 private wells and public sources. And based on their findings, they estimate at least one forever chemical would be detected in 45% of all drinking water samples across the country. But there are more than 12,000 types of these chemicals, and researchers weren't able to test for all of them, meaning the number of people drinking contaminated water may be even higher than what the study found.
Well, day four, and still no answers from more than a dozen residents evacuated from their homes in Rolling Hills Estates due to a massive landslide.
An important heads up for anyone who banks with Bank of America.
Yeah, the U.S. government has ordered the company to pay more than $100 million to customers over illegal fees and other issues. The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau says Bank of America will also have to pay $150 million in penalties for issues dating back to 2012.
Alabama Senator Tommy Tuberville currently holding up hundreds of military promotions over the Pentagon's abortion policy. Policy offers time off and travel reimbursement to service members who have to travel out of state for an abortion. And now for the first time since 1859, the Marine Corps is operating without a Senate-confirmed commandant.
The U.S. military is in the middle of what is a massive recruiting drought. In 2022, the U.S. Army had its most difficult recruiting year since it ended the draft in 1973. Other branches are struggling too, leaving the Army, Navy, and Air Force roughly 30,000 recruits short of their goals.
By the authority vested in me as president by the Constitution and the laws of the United States of America, including sections 121 and 12304 of Title 10 United States Code, I hereby determine that it is necessary to augment the active armed forces of the United States for the effective conduct
of Operation Atlantic Resolve
in and around the United States European Command's area of responsibility. In furtherance of this operation under the stated authority, I hereby authorize the Secretary of Defense and the Secretary of Homeland Security with respect to the Coast Guard, because they work under the Navy, under their respective jurisdictions, to order to active duty any units and any individual members not assigned to a unit organized to serve as a unit of the selected reserve, or any member in the individual ready reserve mobilization category and designated as essential under regulations prescribed by the secretary concerned, and not to exceed 3,000 total members at any time, of whom not more than 450 may be members of the individual ready reserve as they deem necessary, and to terminate the service of those units and members ordered to active duty. What does this even mean? Let me tell you. Biden activated 3,000 reserve troops. 450 of those troops come from the individual ready reserve, otherwise known as the inactive ready reserve, or the IRR. That is not people that are ready to deploy, not even people that are ready to be in the military. Those are people that got out. If you sign up for 4 or 6 and you just do one enlistment, you're actually signing up for 8 years, but you're active for 4 or 6, and you're maybe your reserve for 4 or 6, and then your IRR for the other remaining 2 or 4 years. That's just automatic. Everybody, if you are logistics, if you're special forces, you just stay on IRR when you get out. So they're pulling 450 people off the couch. If you look into the history of the IRR being activated, it's like once per presidency and or once per president, and it's for mainly diseases or, you know, 9/11. Operation Atlantic Resolve is the operation that it's just dealing with Russia in Ukraine. That's the operation that started in October of 2014, just in reaction to Russia taking Crimea. So news is absolutely void of anything to do with this. It's very interesting to me because you'll see news anchors all the time being like, oh my gosh, we're just getting this hot off the presses. I'm reading it as I'm giving you the news. And then when something like this comes out and they're like, we're activating as many as 450 reserves off the couch and up to 3,000 at any time, it's the wording is very precise and it doesn't give any sort of timeline for how long these people might have to change their life course. I would say that there is legal precedent to push back. If you're somebody that's being recalled, if you're in IRR and you are thinking, I don't want to go back, and they're giving me a phone call and they're saying, hey, head on back, I would love to know about it. Hit me up. I will definitely talk to you about it. I'll send you information on lawyers that you can talk to. I will reach out personally to lawyers that I know just to see if there's anything that can be done. I will help you not go fight Joe Biden's war for sure, because this is not something that we should be involving ourselves in and trying to get back into the military in any way to try and help.
And by the way, I discussed this with our allies, discussed this with our friends up on the Hill. And we're in a situation where Ukraine continues to be brutally attacked across the board by munitions, by these cluster munitions that have dud rates that are very, very low, I mean, very high, that are dangerous to civilians, number one. Number two, the Ukrainians are running out of ammunition. The ammunition that they call them 155 millimeter weapons. This is a war relating to munitions and the running out of that ammunition, and we're low on it. And so what I finally did, took the recommendation of the Defense Department to not permanently, but to allow for in this transition period where we get more 155 weapons, these shells for the Ukrainians, to provide them with something that has a very low dud rate. It's about one, I think it's 150, which is the least likely to be blowing. And it's not used in civilian areas. They're trying to get through those trenches. And the
series of explosions at a chemical plant shaking homes miles away. Flames and billowing smoke followed at least six blasts at the facility near Baton Rouge last night. Overnight, residents in a half-mile radius were told, stay indoors, turn off air conditioning. No one was hurt, and airborne hazardous materials have not been detected.
Now to a massive pipeline explosion happened in Texas, and it rattled homes in the area. You could see, look at that, a huge ball of flames and a plume of thick black smoke. You could see it from miles away. This happened in Brazoria County, about 50 miles south of Houston. The company that owns the pipeline says the fire was caused by a chemical release. Thankfully, nobody was hurt, and officials say there's no impact on residents or nearby businesses. An air monitoring crew, however, is on the scene.
The Ringneck Energy Ethanol plant in Oneida was rocked by an explosion and fire Sunday afternoon. Six employees were at work at the time of the explosion, but no one was hurt.
The chief of the Oneida Volunteer Fire Department says there is major structural damage to the ethanol processing portion of the plant. The sheriff's office has secured the scene, and 1 mile of old Highway 83 will be closed until further notice.
But for now, they're no longer allowing anybody into these parking lots while they continue to investigate an explosion in an underground vault here along Sepulveda. Live in Sky 5, I'm Rich Prickett. I'll send it back to you in Hollywood.
Firefighters responded to an underground vault fire on Pacific Avenue. Windows in nearby buildings were blown out, and a car parked on the manhole was also destroyed.
So I'm very thankful that I wasn't in the vehicle, and I'm thankful that there were no injuries.
Gunit Kaur had parked her Tesla and went to dinner with her sister when she got a notification that her car alarm was triggered.
I get there, and another explosion happens, and I have it on video. Unfortunate because I just bought the car and it's my first car ever.
PG&E says when its crews got to the scene, they saw smoke coming from an underground vault and confirmed an underground transformer failed. Customers did lose power, but it was restored overnight and no injuries were reported.
Here in Dorchester, police say a mother was getting out of her truck when a person jumped into that vehicle and took off with her baby inside. That vehicle making it all the way to where we are now, Leroy and Geneva Avenue, before realizing that that baby was in the backseat and dropping that child off outside on the sidewalk. That person then continued to drive, making it about a mile away from here, which is where they ultimately ditched that truck.
Next tonight, new details in that urgent manhunt for a murder suspect on the loose. Michael Burham escaped from a Pennsylvania jail on Thursday. Police say he's armed, dangerous, and a self-taught survivalist with military experience. Just a short time ago, police said that he may be receiving help. They've also found stockpiles of supplies or campsites that they believe are associated with him. Authorities are asking homeowners to check their security cameras.
Investigators estimate Burham may have had a 90-minute head start getting away because police could not access the jail surveillance video they needed to determine which direction he ran in.
They are leaning on the public's assistance here for tips, offering a combined $9,500 reward for information leading to an arrest.
15 different law enforcement agencies and more than 200 officers on the ground are now involved with the search. The reward for any information leading to his arrest is now approaching $20,000.
And police say, based on looking at that video, they seem to believe that Michael Burham may actually be injured. They maintain he may have injured his leg or his ankle when he rappelled down that wall with those bed sheets last Thursday, making his escape.
At 3:57 this afternoon, our tip line received a call from some residents on Jackson Run Road in Conowango Township, Warren County, about a suspicious individual. 5:50, Burham was in custody.
All four bodies were found in heavy brush within 500 yards of one another, dumped over the course of 18 months along a remote stretch of Ocean Parkway, 40 miles from New York.
Since 2010, the bodies of at least 10 women have been discovered along Ocean Parkway on Long Island. No arrests have been made in this case until today. Rex Huerman was arrested this morning.
Authorities say he was arrested in Manhattan. He is an architect.
For each individual victim, he had secured a burner phone. He used it to communicate with those victims. We also know that his Chevy Avalanche, a car with specific identifying information, was used in this. We know all of the victims were found in a similar area. They all worked as escorts. They were all bound in a similar way. They were all wrapped in a similar burlap that was camouflage, purposely trying to hide these bodies. We know that apparently the suspect had made more than 200 Google searches, things including compulsively searching for pictures of the victims' families, of the victims' children, looking for searches on torture, on women specifically being attacked, raped, killed. We know that he was also searching to see what investigators were doing. He was trying to look into this task force.
But what's really important to know is when you say like 10, you know, where remains of 10 people have been found, there are four women in particular, which we, you know, call the Gilgo Beach murders. And they were likely, most investigators have always believed they were killed by a single person. That's the only thing we can actually say, because those four women who were found in December 2010 were killed in the same manner, were found very close to each other, were wrapped in burlap in the same way. It was only weeks later that they found these other remains along. So we need to make it clear that we don't know. In fact, this individual will be charged with four murders or more than that.
One of the things that we learned in the criminal complaint today is that they have cell phone records that show that the suspect's wife was out of town at the times that he was involved with the women who ended up dead on the side of Ocean Parkway. So
I should point out that what's interesting about the case is those four women were actually found because of another woman who disappeared in May of 2010. And this was Shannon Gilbert. She disappeared actually from a different place, Oak Beach. And when they were looking for her is when they came across the four bodies in December of 2010 along Ocean Parkway, and then found other remains also along Ocean Parkway.
But they say Sherman was positively ID'd back in March of 2022, first after a witness described him, then a description matching his Chevy pickup truck, then data listing his address in the so-called box.
Hairs that did not match those victims that belonged to a man that were found on the scene so many years ago. Well, investigators, once they were on to Huerman, they waited for him to throw out some trash. He threw out a pizza box, and on that pizza box, according to the indictment, was a crust inside the box that he had not completed eating. And from that pizza crust, they were able to find enough of his DNA to match with the hair found on the victims at the scene. And that was a key piece of evidence that helped get to this location, this point.
The DA tells me they're looking for some sort of vault that may hold guns, adding that Huerman had 92 firearm permits.
Among other things, there's some storage units that we've searched.
Paving the way for a possible trial early next year. In a letter to Trump and Carroll's lawyers, the U.S. Justice Department said it no longer believed Trump was acting in his capacity as president in June 2019, when he allegedly made defamatory comments about Carroll in response to her accusations that he raped her. Carroll has already won a $5 million jury verdict against Trump earlier this year for a second lawsuit that found he was liable for sexual abuse and defamation. Trump is appealing that verdict. The DOJ's Tuesday filing reverses its earlier position from early on in the Biden administration that Trump was protected because he was president when he made the remarks.
Meanwhile, DOJ officials may delay Hunter Biden's plea hearing after explosive whistleblower claims that Attorney General Merrick Garland interfered with the probe and lied to Congress under oath. Iowa Senator Chuck Grassley sending a new letter saying that the IRS investigators were left out of a briefing on the Biden family alleged criminal scheme.
Testimony is absolutely shocking. I mean, these whistleblowers who were investigating the Hunter Biden case basically found that he had evaded taxes to the tune of over $2 million on $8 million of money that he had received, including, by the way, an $80,000 diamond, a $142,000 Porsche, and supposedly all of this is from
China sources, Ukraine sources, and Romania sources.
Lawyers who had business before the Supreme Court paid money to a top aide to Justice Clarence Thomas. The newspaper discovered the public Venmo account of one of Thomas's aides. The aide's account seemed to show that he received seven payments in November and December of 2019 from lawyers who previously served as Thomas' legal clerks. Upon further digging, The Guardian noted that it seemed that the purpose of each payment is listed as either Christmas party, Thomas Christmas party, CT Christmas party, or CT Xmas party, in an apparent reference to the justice's initials. Who are these folks enjoying these Christmas parties? Reportedly, there are people who have had successful business before the court, including someone who argued the affirmative action case, a former White House deputy counsel in the Trump administration, and the former Solicitor General of West Virginia, who had a key role in a case before the court that limited the EPA's ability to regulate greenhouse gases. One ethical expert did note that it was possible that the former clerks were paying their own party expenses and not expenses for Thomas. All of this comes on the heels of yet another explosive report by the New York Times about how Clarence Thomas gave unusual access to the Horatio Alger Association, a group of ultra-wealthy individuals who dole out scholarships.
The New York Times reports Jones gifted Thomas with a Super Bowl ring. The Times says Cowboys are Thomas's favorite team, and the Justice, quote, struck up a friendship with him. The report claims Thomas has flown in Jerry Jones's private jet, attended Cowboys training camp, and sat in the owner's box during some Dallas-Washington games.
unbelievable crash here at Long Beach Airport. This happened around 2:18 this afternoon when Long Beach Fire Department got the call of a plane crash here at Long Beach Airport on the south side of the runway. I'm zooming in to show you where this plane ended up. Nose first right down into a hangar here on the south side of the airport. Now, unbelievably, the pilot was the only person on board. That person was only sustained minor injuries, I should say. Fire department got on scene to rescue that pilot. FAA is saying that the pilot was doing takeoffs and landings at the time of the crash, but the fire department was able to get on that roof and rescue that pilot. They
Camp Pendleton, where a missing 14-year-old girl has finally been found and a Marine has been taken into custody in connection with her disappearance.
That girl's family now alleging she was trafficked and sold to a Marine for sex.
A sideshow in the Sacramento area turned hostile after an Amazon truck approached this unknown intersection. Spectators started climbing onto the semi and throwing objects at it.
Just in full, a big rig is starting to get mobbed by the crowd.
These images captured by the California Highway Patrol Air Division shows eventually spectators allegedly broke into the cargo container, but the driver was able to get away unharmed and with most of the cargo. CHP says hundreds of vehicles and spectators were at this incident, and with the help from Elk Grove and Sacramento Police Departments, multiple people were arrested.
Beer police say around 9 o'clock Friday night, a group of kids on scooters and mopeds pumped gas at the Gulf Station on Broadway and Revere, then turned on the station clerk, stealing money out of his pocket, assaulting him, and knocking him to the ground. Man who was attacked is here at work today. Ibrahim is a staple in this community, always working the night shift to pump gas to loyal customers.
He's really genuine, and we all love him, and I just hope they catch him because my heart broke this morning.
Slews of those customers have stopped by to support this business and its employees after seeing that video. They say this gas station has been there for them even when they're strapped for cash, and they hope police can catch the kids who did this.
We pray for the kids who did this thing, you know. They're young, so we pray for them to heal.
Five tourists and a pilot are dead after a helicopter crash near Mount Everest. Officials say the helicopter went down this morning when it was returning from a sightseeing trip. The tourists were from Mexico and the pilot was from Nepal.
Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu was admitted to the hospital on Saturday and diagnosed with dehydration, according to his office, which also said the 73-year-old leader was experiencing dizziness but was in good condition. He moved to calm worries by issuing a brief video message reportedly from his hospital room near Tel Aviv. In it, he says he feels well and advises those watching to, quote, spend less time in the sun, drink more water, and may we all have a good new week. Netanyahu, Israel's longest serving leader, said he had been on holiday at the Sea of Galilee on Friday during a heat wave. Temperatures there reached 108 degrees Saturday.
Looking at China now, Chinese state-linked hackers breached the email accounts of U.S. Commerce Secretary Gina Raimondo and senior State Department officials in an attempt to gain access to sensitive information. In fact, the hackers infiltrated the accounts back in May, operating until the espionage campaign was discovered by Microsoft on June 16th. That was just a few days before Secretary of State Anthony Blinken's trip to China. So we found out about this, and Blinken still went to China and then followed up and sent Janet Yellen to China.
North Korea firing a long-range intercontinental ballistic missile off its east coast just days after Pyongyang threatened to shoot down U.S. reconnaissance planes. It landed between the Korean Peninsula and Japan. So
just over 2 weeks after their ill-fated mutiny, troops from the Wagner mercenary group are surrendering their arms. Weapons, ammo, and hardware have been turned over to Russia's defense ministry.
A foreign minister says Moscow will view F-16 fighter jet transfers to Ukraine as a nuclear threat. Sergei Lavrov clarifying his position over the plane's capacity of carrying nuclear weapons. Ukrainian pilots are being trained on how to fly F-16s, but countries have stopped short of making concrete pledges.
Indian Army formations are carrying out drills in eastern Ladakh to cross the Indus River and attacks in enemy positions. Large number of tanks and armored vehicles have been deployed in the world's highest river valleys. This comes after the Chinese forces started showing aggression in the eastern Ladakh sector by diverting its training exercise troops. The two sides are still locked in a standoff in few friction points. According to reports, there have been five major friction points. Very recently, Indian External Affairs Minister Dr. S. Jaishankar also stated, and I quote here, The state of the border will determine the state of the relationship between India and China, and the state of the border today is still abnormal.
Launch of India's Chandrayaan-3 spacecraft. This is the moment that it took off just under an hour ago. It entered Earth's orbit shortly after. It's India's second attempt at a lunar landing, and if it's successful, the craft will deploy a rover near the moon's south pole next month, and India will become only the fourth country behind the US, the former Soviet Union and China to manage a controlled lunar landing.
Some prominent actors left the London premiere of Oppenheimer early tonight in solidarity with the strike.
My name's Screw, you're watching Regular Veteran. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you on the internet. I'm not gonna be posting for a month, so I'll see you when I get back. Thanks so much for, you know, checking out the news, getting your news from me.